Good morning, church.
Good morning.
What a pleasure to be here with you this morning, especially when we are in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
Where everything is made possible. We serve a God of impossibility, but only to those who believe.
Yes.
When you walk into his sanctuary, in his presence, you should come with expectations.
Yes.
He is waiting for that. Don't come with complaints and all that stuff. He knows about them already.
Amen.
And then this is how we approach it. I don't want to talk too much, you know, when Amen. I get going. I keep on going. It's a pleasure to be with you, Renee.
Yes, and you too, Eli. We've never done this before. We've hardly had a conversation outside of church. So we're excited about talking to you this morning. Conversations about finance. You know, I was thinking about when churches talk about money, that oftentimes the thought is, oh, all that church wants is your money. That's why they talk about it. And is my earring, I think my earring's causing a rumble. There we go. But did you know that in the Bible, that tithe is mentioned 40 times in the Bible, and money and possessions are mentioned 800 times? 15% of all Jesus' parables were about money. 11 of the 39 parables were on money. And there are over 500 verses in the Bible on prayer, but 2,000 on money. So let's define a few things, a few of the conversations. The word tithe means a tenth part of anything. A tenth part of anything. And I have found that there's three kinds of views in the church on tithing. All right, so the first view, you'll find people who believe tithing is a requirement. And when they talk about that, you'll hear them talk about the Old Testament, and they'll say tithing is required. Now, there are some of you that are in here that is your, that's what you believe, tithing is required. There's another part of the church that believes tithing is not required. And they'll use scripture verses from the New Testament. And they'll say, well, tithing was the Old Testament. And then the third view is people are, I don't have a clue. How many find yourself in that boat? I don't know. Maybe it is. Maybe it isn't. But regardless of your view on money, it doesn't change how we get to heaven. If you give tithes and offerings or you don't give tithes and offerings, that's not how you get to heaven. Does everybody know that? We get to heaven by one way only, and that is faith in Jesus Christ, not any good works. So if you're in view number one, that tithing is required, or if you're in view number two, that tithing's not required, or you're in view three, that you have no idea, how about you just relax today? This message is for you. Amen? Amen?
Amen.
All right. Thank you. So why did Jesus talk so much about money? Why did he talk so much about money? Because money is a heart issue. Money reflects our heart. And how we think and behave with money is a reflection of our spiritual condition. So Jesus talked about money a lot. And every aspect of our Christian walk, including money, is a matter of the heart and an act of faith. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Come on, y'all. I'll say it again. Every part of your Christian walk, including money, every part, is about an act of faith and a matter of your heart. Amen? All right. Your view of God will have a direct impact on your finances and the impact that your finances have on the kingdom of Christ. Now, remember, we don't get to heaven by works. But could I just say that you can't have the heart of God and not want to do good? Because God is good. That's his nature. He is good. All right, so let's read a story from the Bible. Now, I'm keeping watch on my time up there because I don't want to encroach on Eli's time. So Matthew 25 says, "For it is just like a man who is about to go on a journey, and he called his own slaves and entrusted his possessions to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, each according to his own ability, and they went on a journey. Immediately, the one who had received the 5 talents, well, I'm trying to get it to change here. Y'all see what I'm doing? All right, there we go. Immediately, the one who received the 5 talents went and traded them and gained 5 more talents. And in the same manner, come on, little iPad. Oh, it changed. Good. All right, and in the same manner, the one who'd received the 2 talents gained 2 more. But he who received the 1 talent went away and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. Now, not long after that time, the master of the slaves came and settled the accounts. I'll just keep going. You might or might not get to read it with me. The one who'd received the 5 talents came and brought 5 more talents, saying, Master, you entrusted 5 talents to me, and I've gained 5 more. And his master said, Well done, thou good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things, and I'll put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of the master. And the one who'd received the 2 talents came up and said, Master, you gave me 2, and see, I gained 2 more. And his master said unto him, Well done, thou good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things, and I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. And the one also who'd received the 1 talent came up and said, Master, I knew you were a hard man. You reaped where you did not sow, and you gathered where you didn't scatter any seed. And I was afraid, and I went away, and I hid your talent in your ground, in the ground. See, what you have is yours. So in this story, the 5 talents, the 3 talents, and the 1 talent, it represents money. It represents some type of financial something. Why were the men given different amounts? Why was one given 5, 1 given 3, and 1 given 1? It's in our scripture verse. Can you remember what it said? It said that they were given different amounts based on what they could handle. So some were given, one was given 5, and 1 was given 3, and 1 was given 1. Do you know, oftentimes when we receive something from the Lord, we look at other people and see what they have, and we think, I wish I had what they had. I wish I had that. I wish I could do that. Listen, God gives us what we can handle. And here's what we need to ask the Lord. We need to say, Lord, let me receive all that I can handle and still keep you first. Because we don't need to be jealous of what others have. We need to keep God first. Because we all get something. Amen? God only looks to what, he only is looking at you with what you did with what he gave you. And so if we look at these 3 men, here's what I interpret from the scripture. The first 2 men knew the heart of the master. I'm having a tough time this morning hanging on to papers. Let's move this over here. The first 2 knew the heart of the master. The 3rd one did not. He thought the master was a hard man, and it affected what he did with what he was given. If your view of God is that he is hard, it will affect what you do with what you're given, because you'll live in fear. You'll be afraid. Do you see the first 2 men? They weren't afraid. They said, you gave me 5? Let me do something with it. And they brought it back, and the master said, well done. So our view of God definitely affects our finances. It affects what we do with our finances, and it's going to affect what the kingdom, what happens with our finances. So here's my first point. All things belong to God. That's the first proper perspective we have to get about God. Everybody say it with me. All things belong to God. Colossians 1 tells us he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creations. For by him all things were created, both in the heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. And he is before all things and in all things, and he holds all things together. That's what the rest of the scripture says. You're just going to have to trust me because it's not turning. There we go. So all things belong to God. I want you to think about everything that you have access to. Can you think of anything that was made that did not first come from the earth? What about the chairs you're sitting on? Aren't those formed from something that came from the earth? Everything we have came from the earth. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. That's the next verse. The earth is the Lord's and all it contains, and the world and those who dwell in it. Listen, our first proper view on finances has to be that all things belong to God. Say that one more time.
All things belong to God.
We don't own anything. We don't own anything. We are a steward, and God wants us to use what he has given us. All right, my second point this morning is gratitude will produce generosity. Being grateful will help you get a proper view of God. Now, we're going to read part of this, and you're going to read it with me. You get to read the second line, for his loving kindness is everlasting. I'm going to read the first, and you're going to read the second, because we're going to get some gratitude in here, all right? Here we go. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Give thanks to the God of gods.
Kindness is everlasting.
Okay, y'all say it with some enthusiasm. And if it doesn't come up on the screen, I'm trying really hard. When I pause, do y'all know what to say? Okay, here we go. Give thanks to the Lord of Lords.
For his loving kindness is everlasting.
To him who alone does great wonders.
For his loving kindness is everlasting.
To him who made the heavens with skill.
For his loving kindness is everlasting.
To him who spread out the earth above the waters.
For his loving kindness is everlasting.
To him that made the great lights.
For his loving kindness is everlasting.
The sun to rule by day.
For his loving kindness is everlasting.
The moon and the stars to rule by night.
For his loving kindness is everlasting.
And Psalms 136 goes on and on and on about the loving kindness and the goodness of God. Listen, God is always good. That is his nature. He is always good. And if you have the proper perspective of God, if you understand that all things belong to him and he is always good, it frees you up to give what you have and not be afraid. But if you don't understand who God is, you're like that third person that digs a hole and says, oh, what if I'm afraid? I'm going to dig this hole, bury this, and save it for later. The Bible says, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Give thanks unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his loving kindness is everlasting. And Philippians tells us, whatever things are true and honorable and right, to think on these things, to have a proper perspective of who God is. Let me tell you, there are blessings that come when you tithe. God's word is true. There are blessings that come when you give offerings, because God's word is true. And what the Lord wants for us to do is not live in condemnation, but ask him, Lord, what is the next step you want me to take in my Christian walk? Maybe you've never given. Maybe your next step is to give for the first time. Or maybe you've been giving, but you haven't been tithing. And maybe God will speak to you this morning. I want you to tithe. Listen, whatever he says to you to do, it's for your good and for your benefit. Can you say amen?
Amen.
I've got 2 minutes. And I'm going to turn it over to Eli because I can't wait to hear what he has to share this morning. But you know, when you have a child in the home and you ask them to give something, if you're a good parent, you ask them to give you something, not so that you can take from them, but maybe there's somebody else that you want to bless and you've got something bigger that you want to give them. But oftentimes I see Christians behave like a child who's afraid. God says, give this. And they go, what? Wait, why? Why do you want me to give that? Who are you going to give to? Why do they need it? I want it. Why are you asking me to give it? It's mine. You gave it to me. But wait, why? When we ask our children to give something, what do we want them to say? Come on. Okay. Because they trust us and they know our nature and that we know we're not going to hurt them. When God speaks to you to give, you can trust his nature. He loves you. He isn't going to hurt you. He is always good. He's always good. And when you give, God does something supernatural with what we give, and when he gives it back in the earth, it's an amazing thing to be part of what God is doing through our finances. Amen. All right, Eli, take it away.
All right, wasn't she wonderful? Amazing. Like I told her, I was willing to learn a lot from her, and I did. Now, you know, I'm not a financial advisor by any means, and what I know that works for me And then God asked me to share this little story with you. I don't have time to go over all these things that I have here. There's a lot, but I think the Holy Spirit is taking it over on a different level. I'm from Haiti, the poorest country in the Western Hemisphare. I came here in 1992 with nothing. And here I am. I'm not going to tell you what I have. But here I am. I don't say that I'm blessed. I wouldn't say that. The reason why I don't say that I'm blessed is because in the kingdom of God, blessing is expected. You see, if you take one of the, like for instance, Prince Charles, he would never see money as a blessing. Never. He's like, what are you talking about? I was born in this thing. So in the kingdom of God, this is where all the children of God are making the biggest mistake of their life. The provision has been made.
Amen.
You just have to believe it, walk in it, trust it, and go for it, and take it home with you, and then bring some to church. I'm not reading this. I'm talking from the heart. Life experience. I am an evangelist. I do believe in God. And he does talk to me. This is a small town, and I've been in Stateville for 20-some years, and I can't say everything in this here because I know there are people listening and watching this. But my children, they can tell you, the oldest one, especially even the one youngest one too, at my house, we don't waste food. No. And when you know Eli, everybody here must know Eli. And one time, Eli, he used to go to the fridge, get a bunch of milk or juice, he put a bunch of it in the cup, or take a bunch of food, eat it, and then leave it on the table. And I'm like, I have enough of this. And one time he did that, and I took the food and left it there. It was sitting on the table. And the next day, I said, you're going to eat that food. He's like, what? I said, yes. I told you 1,000 times not to waste food. Just take enough that you need. Your daddy, no, but I don't want. I said, well, you're going to eat it. I'm sorry, guys. I'm bad. I'm not afraid to say that. I'm not ashamed. Just for the glory of God, I'm saying that. I made him eat it. In the next 5 hours, he was throwing up. He was having a bad. I'm like, What did I want to do here? I wanted to teach him a lesson. But at the same time, you know what he said to me, which was good? He said, Daddy, you're talking about not wasting food. You said people are dying in Africa for food and we're wasting it. You said, but I was not born in Africa. I've always had food since I've been born. And then that opened up my eyes about God. You see? Are you with me? Are you with me?
Yes.
When you live here, you should leave not the same way you walked in, right, believing that God, your Father in heaven, the Jehovah Jireh, he has made all the provisions when it comes to this. You see, if you look at it, the Bible talks a lot about money, but Jesus didn't preach too much about prosperity because he knows it's expected. He talks about a lot of other things. Now, If I go back to this, I hope you guys understand. Are you feeling me?
Yeah.
Is the Holy Spirit talking to you?
Yeah.
In Matthew 6, verse 31 to 33, it says, so do not worry saying, what shall we eat? Or shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them too. But, I like but. It's a conjunction of coordination that shows a contrast, an opposite. I mean, Renee is the teacher. All the teachers know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
But, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given
to you
as well. Amen. Clap your hands for the whole. Come on. Yeah. Clap your hands for God. Come on. Yeah. This is big. Yeah. This is my life. And it has always worked. Now, I'm sorry. I know I'm not looking at this. Like I told you, God does stuff like that, and I love it. The other part of this is, the Bible says to seek first the kingdom of God, because he knows that, like I said, in the kingdom, everything is there for you, what you're worried about on earth. Renee just told you, everything God has prepared for you. The Mother Earth has it. And we've been fed from generation to this generation because of crops and all that stuff that God had provided.
Yes.
Yep. We're still eating. Our children are still eating. Yes. Great, 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 great grandchildren. They will always, God will always be taking care of them.
Yes.
But, you know, the other part of this is sometimes things may not go well for you, especially when you are a Christian, you're serving God. God wants to test you. He wants to know, are you relying on what you have, on your wealth and everything else? Because these things on earth mean nothing. Because might can take them. You know, you have moth and vermin that will take these things. He said, put your treasure in heaven. Right. In heaven where nothing can touch it.
That's right.
I'm preaching. I'm sorry. This
you're
was stupid
good.
To be a conversation,
you're
but it's
good.
Turning into a preaching.
Preach away. You have 8 minutes.
I just look at Brother Nick here as I see him. Mm-hmm. We have a story together. I don't know if we would give permission to talk about it. Okay, he gave me permission to go. One of my children, I'm not going to say which one, we have issues. And I'm not afraid to talk about my life. Because I think every Christian's life should be a testimony for God. Yes. So other people that are going through the same thing could understand that we, even if we look like this, we have problems. We have issues in our life. Okay? We do. So my daughter hasn't been in my house for a long time. And then called me one day. She said, Dad, I want to talk to you. And, you know, after high school, she left. She didn't want to go to college and all that stuff. And then if she's listening, watching this, she knows it's the truth. My wife is here. Everybody can witness that. And she's been out of my house. And then she even, at one point, rented from me. And a house that I have for rent, she rented from me. And then she quit. She left it. But she came back. She told me that she wanted to come home. And then she asked me to meet her somewhere. And I said, I don't know. The Holy Spirit was guiding me. And I said, no, let's meet at Chick-fil-A. Oh, no. Everything about Chick-fil-A is good. They don't pay me to say that, okay? They don't open on Sunday, by the way, because God takes care of them. But while I went there, that was not the plan originally, but we went there together, started talking, and she was saying that she wants to come back home, and I was telling her, you know, my rules have not changed. College, education, you know, you have to go to school if you're going to live here, and you're going to have to stop the other things that you're doing. And then as we were talking about this, and then Brother Nick was in there with his son. But we didn't see each other, like we just passed each other, we didn't talk. And then the Holy Spirit guided me to ask him to come. My daughter asked for prayer. She said, can we get some, can we pray? I said, well, yeah. And I asked Brother Nick to come and pray with us. And he was like, what happened? What's good? What am I praying for? He can confess to that. And it was a good experience. But this is a child that has everything provided for her. And when I say everything, ladies and gentlemen, I mean everything. I didn't have those things that my kids have. Never did. Maybe that's why I asked Eli to eat the food after, because I didn't want him to waste food. I was born between two spectrum. My dad has some money. My mom was very poor. And sometimes I have to go to my mom's house and sleep on the floor. But when I go to my dad, I sleep in bed, in high bed. But I live in both spectrum. I understand what it is to be without. And I understand what it is to have some. So when we raise our children, we want to make sure they understand that. Because it starts from when you're little. Because the discipline will follow you as you grow about money, finances. As a Christian, you should also, if you want to, who in this room doesn't want to be wealthy or get rich? Raise your hand. Oh, thank you. Of course, because you want to be able to help the church. You want to be able to afford the things you can buy. It doesn't give you joy when you have money, right? It doesn't give you happiness when you have money, does it?
No?
And no? Come on now, I'm just playing with you. Money gives you happiness. It does not give you joy. Mike Tyson, you know Mike Tyson, the former boxer. He made a lot of money in boxing, very good at his young age. And then he made a bunch of money. And then in 5 or 10 years, he blew it all up. And then I was watching, and another thing, remind me, I'm going to come back to this. If you want to have something, whatever you want to excel in, you have to, because whatever you spend much of your time in, that's what you become good at. So if you want to have money, to be wealthy, you have to learn about where money comes from God, where everything comes from God. Yeah, who in this earth has money? How did they get it? Warren Buffett, how did they do that? Oprah Winfrey, how did they do that? Read about people who've had money. That will give you an insight about a lot of things how to do. Now I'm going to go back to Tyson. Mike Tyson said, someone asked him at any interview, Mike Tyson, how did it feel to have a bunch of money and so rich, you know, you came from nothing? And at that time, he still had money at that time. And that was his answer. He said, you talk about money making you joyful and having all that stuff. Well, if you think money does that, that means you've never had money. If you think, again, that money will make you joyful, that means you never had it.
Real joy is found in the Lord, isn't it?
Amen. You see, it's good to have a teacher by your side that knows the Bible.
Well, you know, Eli, those are excellent points because we need to know that what we have comes from God, and He gives it to us to be a blessing to each other, to build the kingdom, and He's just a wonderful, He gives us all that we need, and I appreciate your testimony about where you came from. I don't think a lot of people know that you came from Haiti, and that Haiti is the poorest town, the poorest country in the Western Hemisphere, and God gave you opportunities, and you took those opportunities and gave them back to Him, and He's blessed your life because He's always been faithful. Isn't that right?
Amen.
He's always been faithful.
Amen.
Caleb, do we have any questions? All right. The first one is, let me move this iPad. I can't see it. What does seeking first the kingdom of God look like? Eli, you want to take a minute, and what does seeking first the kingdom of God look like?
The kingdom of God. You know, after Jesus Christ was tested, He went through all the testing, and then He came out. He said, the kingdom of God is here. That's what He says. That was His message. The thing that they've been talking about a long time ago, now it is tangible. It is walking around. So what Jesus Christ meant by the kingdom of God is not the kingdom of men. Because in the kingdom of men, what you find is sickness, disease, lack of, okay? And in the kingdom of God, Jesus Christ healed the sick, resurrected the dead. You know, He did all those things to show what the kingdom looked like.
Yeah.
And like I just told you, because you're talking about financing, in the kingdom of God, everybody is wealthy. It's the commonwealth. Mm. Everybody walks in the kingdom. In fact, oh God, let me say this. I preached somewhere last week where we talked about the throne. I'm going to share this because I may never have the chance to say that here. When you go to the tabernacle that represents what it is in heaven, there is the area where you offer sacrifice, that the altar, that's where all the sacrifices are given for your sins, for repentance, for healing, whatever you're looking for, you get that at the altar. When you get to the throne of God, where actually the authority, the majesty, the sovereignty of God. I think, you know, in the Bible, there are five people who talk about the vision that God gave them of his kingdom, of his throne, where he lives, where he resides. I think you have Isaiah, you have Ezekiel, you have John, you have East, you have Stephen. But the one that I liked the most was the one that John gave in Revelation. John talked about Jesus Christ sitting on the throne, and then there were 24 of the thrones with the elders. And what they did, they had crowns also, and they took the crown down and put it down. And then worship Jesus for what he's done for you. This kingdom he has prepared for you. I mean, it started here on earth. Trust me, ladies and gentlemen. It starts here. So the kingdom of God, if you want to picture it like that, it solves all your problems. What this earth, it's the opposite of everything down here that's happening. Yes.
So in this kingdom. How does seeking first the kingdom, what does that look like? Well, for me, I know when I'm in the grocery store and I'm shopping, I'll just ask the Lord, you know, Lord, is there anything here that you want me to do? And I'll just go about my business and shop. And there's been times that I've felt the Holy Spirit drop in my spirit. Pay for that person in front of you. Seeking the kingdom here, there's not a formula. It's just a conversation like we're having here with the Lord. God, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? When I'm in the market, sometimes I pay for people's food. Sometimes I give a word to people. So seeking the kingdom of God is just simply saying, God, what do you want me to do right now in this situation? You know, you can seek God's kingdom when you're washing your dishes as a mama and having a good attitude and thanking the Lord for those dishes. And then if the Lord speaks to you to give a dish away, it's real easy because you realize this dish came from the Lord. I'm giving it back to the Lord and I want to bless somebody. So for me, seeking God's kingdom is just part of what I do. I don't have to take a separate time and say, oh, I'm going to seek the kingdom of God. It's part of who I am and what I do every day. Does that make sense? Now, have I perfected it? Of course not. But it's having a conversation with the Lord. God, what do you want to do in this situation right now in this place?
And if you want to know, read your Bible. Go to Sunday school because they will teach you how to actually seek the kingdom.
How can I be grateful if things are going terrible? Well, gratitude is not dependent upon your state. Gratitude is an issue of the heart. And in this world, you will have trials and tribulations, but be of good cheer. The Bible says, I have overcome the world. So gratitude is an attitude that we have regardless of situations, and that comes from the Lord alone. If you're gratitude comes from your situation, I want to tell you that you'll be schizophrenic and you'll have multiple personalities, because how many of you have started out the day and everything was fine and about 10 minutes later, it's not. And as you are depending, if you are basing being grateful by how your day goes, you're going to be grateful and then you're not going to be grateful. Then you're going to be grateful, then you're not going to be grateful. Then you're going to be grateful and you're not going to be grateful. We are grateful regardless of how our day goes. Can you all say amen? Amen.
Let me say this, if you don't mind. Being grateful when things are going terrible. The Bible gave an analogy of those 10 people with leprosy. Jesus healed them all. And he told them, go to the priests to verify that you've been healed. But they were healed yet. They were just walking to the priest. There was the Samaritan, the one that didn't even supposed to believe in God. He returned back. And then he said, thank you.
Thank you.
And Jesus said, what happened to the other nine? Were they not healed? Gratefulness in the midst of terrible things when they happen.
Amen.
It's come to the master. To the master. And be in a position where you recognize who did it for you.
That's right. Rebecca's going to close our service with a song, and it's very appropriate. The song is, God will work it out. God will work it out. He will work it out. We just have to trust him. Can you say with me today, God will work it out.
Work it out.
Hallelujah.
Say. my